The Egyptians were considered participants in the drama of sacred life, as members of the natural cosmic order. In the metaphysical and funerary treatises, the interaction between the Neteru and human beings is described without distinction of such conditions, emphasizing only the purity of the person's life or intentions. Since it was uncovered in the late 19th century, the Dynasty 12 Papyrus A dispute between a man and his Ba has intrigued translators. While the work raises issues about the social conditions of the time it was written, it is without doubt a reflection of Egyptian concepts about the spiritual aspect of one's earthly life, just like the Ba, the Ka, and the transformation of the soul. In ancient Egypt, sacred anatomy has also been used to illustrate spiritual concepts and moral values, elements of great importance for the development of temple students. A natural hierarchy maintains the innate bond between immaterial realms within the sacred anatomy. In funerary texts and esoteric literature, these concepts are vividly illustrated and described with careful detail from the earliest to the latest periods. Egypt's mysterious technology, like its religious cosmology, was a completely made-up system from the beginning of its civilization. There is no evolution of concepts throughout dynastic history, but a complete system from the start. The literature found in coffins and tombs describes many sacred anatomy components. The activities of the initiate are portrayed in these works on many levels of the spirit world. A person undergoes a transformation before entering a particular realm. Initial access to the places of the inner life is not available to humans. Therefore, for each dimension, a transformative change must occur before the journey can begin. Religious literature of some chronological periods is dominated by faith in the sacred anatomy, as with the Neteru, the Ankh spirit, was the instrument of spiritual elevation in the Old Kingdom pyramid texts, while the Ka, double, became more prominent in the Middle Kingdom funerary literature. Where the overall system is concerned, this does not discount anyone's concept in favor of another. That specific spiritual idea became dominant at certain times may appear untenable, but that was because the cosmic climate encouraged their disclosure to the masses, rather than restricting it to members of the royal house of the distinguished temple. Also revealed in the funerary and initiatory literature is that certain parts of the sacred anatomy are often more closely associated with Anita than others. For example, Orset is often depicted as a protector of the Ba in temples and tombs, while Heter is always associated with the body's physical needs, such as hunger and thirst. The hieroglyphic names or characters used to describe the spiritual bodies represent many of these associations. Shadow of the Sun. Kybit refers to the shadow or mirror image of a person, an animal or elemental of metaphysics that is invisible. Indigenous cultures that recognize the existence of this principle do not view it as inferior, but rather to subtly connect with nature and its phenomena. The soul contains the intelligence that works through the body's autonomic functions in organic life. Kybits, for example, are highly sensitive to weather and seasonal rhythms and animal and plant life. It can move freely and protect the soul from threatening forces with its subtle senses of light and sound. At death, it dissolves naturally in the person's image to whom it belongs. Kybit is associated with Heter, the Nita of reflective images. The body of light. Kat refers to the physical form of life, its material body. Being composed of elements prone to decay, it is the earthly vessel of the Ka. Its hieroglyphic determinative is a Nile fish, showing the highly corruptible nature of the flesh. The treatment of the physical body and its maintenance after death have been controversial topics in Egyptology for centuries. Scholars believe that the existence of mummies and elaborate funerary equipment from old dynastic periods indicates the Egyptians believed the body would be resurrected by the returning soul after its journey through the inner life. The need for so much funerary adornment and ritual is justified if we understand mummification as a metaphor for becoming ossified. Asar returned to life, not in the physical world, but in the inner life, becoming a master of those realms. This did not transpire by chance, but by gaining knowledge of the holy region's sacred rituals, names, and geography. In Egyptian cosmology, the physical world mirrors the divine world. What occurs on one plane has a parallel existence on another. Mummification thus served several purposes. There were two ways to ensure the person's spiritual individuation on successive planes of existence. The first way was to reassemble his divided body in the same way that Asar's body was restored. A second was to create an environment where participants in the funerary rites could also experience this individuation. Thus, the annual funerary feast and commemoration of the dead are necessary. Kat, that which decays, is intertwined with Set, the principle of fixation. The earth is the vessel that fixes the various subdued forms of the individual. Aspects of the senses. The four senses of human existence are Ma, sight, Seer, touch, Ku, taste, and Setjen, hearing. They are associated with the four sons of Heru, elemental deities whose presence is crucial for successful magical and funerary ceremonies. Among them are Quetzalcoatl, Seer, lives in the intestines. Damutef, who lives in the stomach. Hapi, Setjen, lives in the lungs. Imset, Ma, who lives in the liver. In sacred geometry, the quaternary establishes physical manifestation. Its embodiment aims to raise the character of material life through the binding of divine forces to a temporal pattern. Hu is also the name of the heavenly food upon which both Neteru and men are sustained. It is based on the belief that earthly food possesses and transmits subdued energy that nourishes the spirit. Hu also refers to authoritative utterance, a term frequently used in Egyptian theurgy, but perhaps more appropriately described as conscious expression. As a result, Ma, or the Seer One, was one of the highest tides of Heliopolis high priests. The Legend of Night and the Book of Gates depict Seer and Hu as voyagers, with the soul of the sun bark as it travels through the sky. Seer, the sense of touch, can also refer to knowledge, understanding, or perception of anything outside the center of one's being, perhaps an analogy for our quest for consciousness. There was an Egyptian belief that the human senses could be elevated to and exercised on spiritual planes. Through all the transformations of human experience, the sacred literature continuously emphasizes the importance of maintaining the body's functions and senses. In the initiate literature of the pyramid texts, the vitalization of the four roles is a preliminary ritual. According to the funerary books, restoring the four functions is also a prerequisite for empowering the Ka to breathe and take in nourishment. In the cosmological world of Arkut, the four senses originated as functions of Heka, a child of Neit and Khnum. In the funerary text, Heka is described as possessing the ability to produce, transmit, and absorb magical forces. Physically, Heka contributes to the maintenance and continuation of life. It is difficult to define the principle of this divinity, as he seems to embody a distinct force, whether divine or human. His significance as Anita can be understood from the four senses as emanations of Heka. As the Egyptians saw it, one's personal power is derived from the extension of one's intentions and the ability to cultivate them beyond ordinary experiences. Heka is expressed and continually made vital through physical reasons. Naming. Egypt has a curious custom that dates back to pharaonic times. Traditionally, people are known by their birth names, which are appended to the terms of their fathers and grandfathers in Islamic tradition. Ahmed Muhammad Hassan, son of Muhammad, and grandson of Hassan, is known as Ahmed. Ahmed may never be known by this name in his village, at work, or within government. He may be recognized to all but his closest family members as Mahmud or Aziz. There is a long-standing belief that the knowledge of one's name can impart one's essential essence to another. A person's name was thought to evoke his passion, his heka, in ancient Egypt. In Egyptian metaphysics, speaking someone's name or a god's name strengthens and perpetuates the connection between them and the living. Rens, in this context, possesses a character that attracts and reinforces life force. Named after the Jed principle, which is the causal principle behind it. The importance of names in the inscriptions of royal persons is most familiar to us from temples and tombs, inscribed with so much care. The titulary of Pharaoh was composed of 5 characters, the first of which was the Heru name. Considering that king was Heru, incarnate on earth, this name represents the expression of the Nita. The name Netbi, two ladies, refers to his role as a transmitter of ancient tradition, depicted by Nekhebet, the vulture, and Wojet, the cobra. Golden Heru symbolizes the exalted initiatory position of the king concerning the spiritual agenda of his kingship. The name was conferred after the crowns were received. Nesubiti, Sejun B, symbolized the royal role in the two lands, and the son of Ra's name represents the expression of that Neteru through Pharaoh's body. The obscurity of someone's name represented a specific denial of eternal life. Hence, funerary protocol required that the deceased's name be engraved on all tomb equipment, ensuring that his identity would continue into the spiritual realm. As a sign of his entrance into spiritual life and ongoing recognition by the Neteru, some memorial notes include a second name, the Good Name, in the pyramid texts. This name is praised. On earth, your name flourishes. You will never decay. You will never perish. But you will live forever and ever. 764. Utterance. In cultures where the name is a power receptacle, acquiring a new title following spiritual empowerment, Ren is connected with the Nemt Het, the Nita who nourishes the transformed soul upon entering its new life. The doppelganger. Ka is a vehicle that facilitates the circulation of Sa's life forces, cosmic, and Sekhem, individual. It is possessed by gods, men, and all natural life. According to Wallace Budge, who has studied Egyptian metaphysical concepts for a lifetime, it existed before the body to which it bonded itself was born. Ka is sometimes called the double of a person and corresponds to the etheric body in metaphysics. For clairvoyance, the aura is a counterpart of the body. The Ka is the body's matrix and carries its imprint in this way. It maintains the shape of all physical characteristics, so that as commonly reported in medicine, a missing limb may still convey sensation or feeling. Besides transmitting vitality between the material and spiritual bodies, the Ka was also said to have an eternal nature. Unlike the etheric double of modern metaphysics, which disintegrates after death, it is believed that the Ka of Egyptian belief served as a cohesive agent for all the bodies of an individual's inner life as they developed through the ages. Ancient Egyptian mystical literature also mentions the Ka as having an intelligent function. According to Wallace Budge, a Ka serves as the physical, form's mental, moral, and spiritual disposition, its sensible guide, its far-seeing protector, and in some ways, acts as its guardian angel. Khnum, principle of distillation, signifies the encoded physical matrix of the seed and the transference of DNA into the matter. As a divine potter, Nita Khnum performs a mystical act before birth that joins the Ka with the child. The Nita spins his potter's wheel to shape the Ka into the likeness of the new human being and infuses it with distinct characteristics. For one royal birth, the Nita crafts 7 forms, cow, at the Temple of Knu in Esna. Every man and woman is shown to hold their own ka, while royal males are often led to control several. Besides kingship, the ka was accompanied by a female counterpart, the hemsut, which was passed only through the royal mother and ensured the continuity of the divine lineage. As an idealized representation of the deceased, the ka statue, the ka, lives in the tomb after death. After the body was mummified by the hemka, a specialized funerary priest, the figure was consecrated to house the ka in the vault. The ka needed physical sustenance provided by the Seten priests, keepers of offerings. They took care of its maintenance and offered food offerings at the tomb. Water and valuable oils were also poured over the ka statue at annual celebrations to purify and refresh the deceased, a practice still observed in the Near East today. In Western society, the tradition of feeding the dead still survives as floral memorials at cemeteries and the annual harvest festival of Halloween. Two outstretched hands are the hieroglyphic determinative of the ka. During visits to the per ka, the deceased was supposed to stretch out his hands through the false door, or more appropriately, a portal to the shadow world, which nourished the ka. The ka's repeated journeys into and out of the physical world are reminiscent of stories about ghosts or shades told throughout history. All living and vital forms contain the ka, the niteru, such as plants, animals, stars, and geographical places. The ka is associated with Asa, governor, and archetype of all the ka of nature and the ancestors in his region of Amented. The ka of a person could be invoked in a tomb, and the ka of the nita could be manifested in a temple. Despite being separate from the physical world, a ka even could embody itself if it were provided with the proper ceremonies and forms to house it. In ancient Egypt's legendary ceremonial art, necromancer priests represented stone statues with the ka of the dead. In the London Leiden Papyrus, the Greco-Romans described this phenomenon, and stories from later Greeks reported that this kind of theurgy was also practiced in Egypt to enable the physical manifestation of Niteru in the temple. Astral body and soul. Although the ba has been described as a ghost or apparition in funerary literature, it refers to the visible representation of any spiritual being, the soul. It is the closest analogy to the astral body as a metaphysical concept. It is possible for the ba to transmigrate. It may enter the physical vehicles of living persons or animals with the proper magical ceremonies. It must be joined to the ka or companion etheric form to accomplish this. If a corpse or body is not available, the ba permanently leaves the site of its former life. When the initiate passes into the inner life, the ba appears as a human-headed hawk. Sometimes the ba is shown with the ka, awaiting transfiguration, hovering over the mummified body in its bird form. Sacred texts almost always include a holy bird to denote the hieroglyphic names of subtle bodies that traverse or live in the inner life. A winged figure represents a spiritual state accessible to humanity, since a bird is a creature of the earth and the sky. Based on symbolist theory, the superior visual lobes of specific bird species represent levels of subtle perception that could be active in human life. Historically, the astral body has been recognized as the vehicle that can come and go from the body without losing consciousness or life, and is capable of innate knowledge of places and things, both in the present and from past lives. According to the instruction of Merikara in Dynasty 18, the ba comes to the place it knows. It does not stray from the path of its former life. Water does not hold it back. It comes to those who offer it. A human head as a bird was expected in amulets to invoke the ba. These were also designed to bring back the ba and protect the body from potentially dangerous influences when the ba was out and visiting the astral plane. In the process of rebirth, the ba assumes a unique form from the human-headed bird. Ba represents the reincarnating soul, which sheds its previous identity, the human head, to embark on a new life. The stork's arrival may be the origin of the age-old metaphor of new birth, as Orset is the Nita who brings forth the astral body. The bar is associated with Orset. A wing flaps over the muniform, Asa, in the Osirian mythos to create wind, or endow him with breath. In the heart and soul. In Egyptian metaphysics, the Ab represents the heart and soul, and the containers of all earthly passions. It is believed that the Ab contains emotional intelligence, the residence of one's honor, dignity, and truth, accumulated throughout one's lifetime. In Tumart, the Ab represents the living memory of an individual that unfolds rapidly at the moment of death. Anpu is associated with the Ab, and its function is to transform decaying matter into vital energy, which occurs during the transition between death and life. As the initiate travels through the shadow worlds, the Ab is weighed against the feather of truth. This sojourn's outcome determines whether the person returns to earthly life, reincarnation, or enters the heavenly realms. Afterward, he guides the soul through the initial regions of the Duat to the judge, presided over by Asa. In the spirit. According to the pyramid texts, the Ankh represents the individual's elevated essence and high intelligence. It is an immutable form of light, capable of transcending time and space, and knowing everything earthly from the past, present, and future. A concept depicted metaphysically as the mental body, the Ankh can span all material dimensions and live on the superconscious plane. Initially, the Ankh existed, dynasties 3-6, but the Ka was supplanted by the Middle Kingdom. This is explained by the critical importance of Egypt's ancestral tradition. Initially, the earliest monarchs viewed by later people as demigods were direct descendants of the Netaru, and they had divine memory knowledge of all sacred beings and their names. In Old Kingdom texts, the initiated person declares, "I am now a very fine Ankh." Arousing and maintaining this memory was critical in maintaining the connection between the royal house and its forebears, a process incorporated into pharaonic initiation. In the liturgy of funerary offerings, the part about purification of the body, spells 28 through 34, several ceremonies empower someone to arouse the Sekhem and become an Ankh. This was done through the mystic reunification of the Ba, astral body, with the Ka, etheric body, in a series of mystical anointings that allow one to have openings before one's eyes, i.e. to awaken clairvoyant perception. The Aku, other transfigured beings, can also see and hear one. By performing this ritual, initiates are also empowered through the ancient mysteries, in which the union of Asa, etheric Ka, and Orset, astral Ba, creates a new function for them, the ability to penetrate and pass through cosmic worlds. In hieroglyphic notation, the Ankh is represented as a crested ibis or phoenix. Arabian birds have brilliant plumage, which is described in the translation of their name, which translates as resplendent light. Other meanings include exaltation and transfiguration, which implies the process by which this vehicle is formed. Ankh is associated with Subdet, a manifestation of Orset manifested through the light of the star Sirius. This Nita handles cosmic cycles and the beginning of the sacred year. When the soul enters this experience phase, it attains a superconscious transcendent state. Resonance of the sacred. By expressing life through the manifestation of the divine word, Jed speech is the principle of verbal articulation. Ancient Egypt did not consider the speech insignificant. Despite its power being regarded as a sacred privilege for all, the Jed direction of Jed also represents a continuous movement, or rhythm of high science, practiced in the temples with chants, accompanied by the holy instruments, the drum, and the sistrum. The original word concept can be found in nearly every ancient culture, as the driving force behind creation. This principle has been viewed as the highest of all creative acts because it is latent until it manifests itself. According to Egyptian belief, the speech gives all things life, a principle derived from the myth of Jehovah's original word, which brought primeval life into motion. His role is like that of the Hindu god Shiva, who represents the cosmic vibration that precedes the appearance of physical form, causing matter to respond cyclically. Therefore, all living things possess a unique frequency, derived from the celestial ambience that existed at their emergence. These frequencies allow the temple mages to summon sacred forces into the sanctuary. In humans, Jehovah is the creative force that gives life to the inanimate physical plane. Jehovah the Neter, whose original act of pronouncing the sacred sound set all forms into motion, is related to this principle. This concept has moral implications. As part of the process of Jed, the law of cause and effect, karma in Hinduism, predestines future events, whether it is a thought, desire, or act. Infinite being. Sahu is a concept of elevated existence both as a being and as a destination, meaning those who are free, noble, and accomplished. According to sacred science, it is the dwelling place of the souls, or the great oversoul. At the end of a great cycle, each life's eternal, incorruptible life essence is rejoined to its origin. In timeless time, the cosmic fire gave form to all individual spirits. The pyramid texts refer to visiting the Sahu or returning to the realm where it exists. Following the sky ascent, the initiate experiences several progressive transformations. The principle is associated with Geb, the Neter, who represents the prototype for humans. As the original and primeval father of a species, he describes the collective soul. Energy is a vital force. An individual's Sekhem is the personification of their vital force and an expression of their will. The fire principle is manifested before any creative, procreative, or magical endeavor in human life. In some ancient texts, it is referred to as the altar of fire. According to Eastern metaphysics, the kundalini energy travels through the spinal cord. They each possess a distinctive Sekhem, which manifests as a magical function in the world. For instance, in the Sekhem of Asar, life is continuous and cyclical. The total of all magical power available to an average person is also personified by his breath and restoration. As the root word implies, this principle is associated with Sekhmet, the incarnate Neter of cosmic fire on earth. Sekhem Mpet means mystical power in heaven, and Sekhem Tawi means magical power of two lands. Life's force. The holy anatomy also incorporates another principle besides the sacred bodies. Everything in the universe is animated and bound by the Sar, the fluid life force. Sar is impersonal and affects every living being. As Sar permeates the physical plane, it acts as an adhesive for all other planes of manifestation. It is comparable to the Greek aether and the Sanskrit akasha, which are both concepts that describe the subtle energy that binds the cosmos together. Temple inscriptions describe special rites that refer to the generation and dispensation of Sar. Through invocations and rituals, these magical ceremonies raised the temple's power. Therefore, the accumulated Sar was distributed to the populace through anointing rites, food offerings, and bathing in the sacred lake at sacred times. Healers, diviners, and divine appearances were believed to be enabled by this. In its cyclical motion, this principle is associated with the body of Newt, the Neter, who provides all living things with cosmic nourishment in her celestial womb. According to Egyptian metaphysics, these immaterial bodies inhabit the subtler planes of the universe, yet they are not limited in their activity, nor are they confined to a particular realm. Just as the physical body can visit many places on the physical plane, for example, the car is a body of the etheric plane that can manifest in the physical world. To accomplish this would require the proper transformation ceremonies with attendant physical sustenance. that would attract the ka to the material world. According to Egyptian magical tales, such occurrences took place regularly in the temple and the tomb. Likewise, when a spiritual body is said to have an intelligence, it is understood to possess the capability of understanding and communicating. Although that body may only associate with the emotional plane, such as the ab or heart soul, this is still true. It is the world of shadows. There are various ways in which the inner life is described in hymns to the Neteru and magical and funerary writings. Each represents a different locale populated by other spirits and forces. The sacred literature refers to four distinct realms in this dimension, appropriately translated as shadow worlds, Nita Kurd, the Duat, Sekhet Etepet, and Amented. They represent detailed complex terrains that mirror or shadow the physical world as we know it. Despite being translated as the underworld, Nita Kurd has an entirely different meaning. This is truly the sky shadow, a realm that reflects the celestial sphere. The hieroglyphic depiction shows a prominent mountain topped by a biliteral Nita, sacred being, whose meaning is revealed in the land of the gods, and in this interpretation, it is accessible to the human soul. The stellar path aims to integrate the individual ka with the ka of cosmic nature. Sacred literature refers to it as the Book of the Divine Cow and the Book of Acre. Duat is a realm that encompasses both the dark and light worlds of the sun, the invisible and visible circuits of the sun. Symbolic of the Duat is the star within the solar disk, the latter being the region's governing luminary. The Duat might also refer to the lower hemisphere of the natural world, where the sun passes after it sets on the western horizon. The goal of the Horion path is to elevate matter, set, into the light of the spirit, Heru, through the balance and synthesis of both principles. There are two sections in the Duat, from south to north. Sekhet Hetepet comprises 14 arts, or regions. As a result, each of the art displays characteristics of the Egyptian geography, but coincide with the 14 Osirian shrines from antiquity and the lunar mirror, which reflects the solar essence in the Duat. This is one of two stations in the Osirian path, governed by the moon. The Sekhet Laru contains 7 arits, divisions, and 21 gates, corresponding to the lunar cycle. Amentet is the first art in Sekhet Hetepet. The earth shadow reflects the human world. This name distinguishes Amentet from Ament, the region of the Neteru, that represents the cosmogenesis of the universe. Amentet is governed by the earth. There is an idyllic region of the Osirian path here, where the rewards of a just life will be granted. As the principle governing the soul's fate, these spiritual destinations are closely related to the Far Eastern concept of karma, Sanskrit, action. Often misunderstood by those cultivated in Western religions, karma is closely related to the idea of reincarnation. It represents the driving force behind spiritual destiny. A person's karma is often viewed as an accumulation of negative past actions that result in retributive experiences in the present, over which a person has no control. Those in power impose the same limits in the present as in the past. Just as a parent harshly punishes a child for naughty behavior, human existence is viewed as a cycle of detrimental paybacks guided by an unmerciful authority, a viewpoint far removed from Egyptian notions of the afterlife. Consequently, Westerners may not understand karma in its Egyptian form, with its dualistic thinking and predisposition to supernatural justice. Stellar, solar Horion, and lunar Osirian funerary paths show the soul's fate in progressive acts of personal transformation, divine synthesis, or in the worst case, a return to the material world for renewal. The mastery and synthesis of one's natural powers, physical and spiritual redemptions, both the individual and the collective to which one belongs, The journey and its outcome are determined by pre-existing actions in each path. The physical nature is elevated in the lunar Osirian direction, enabling the soul to experience higher levels of earthly emotion and material prosperity than those on Earth. Because of the stellar path, the soul is fully renewed. It undergoes a series of cosmic transformations that mimic the universe's genesis, and ultimately, it becomes a cosmic entity existing in harmony with divine life. Egyptologists cannot reconcile the disparate collections of funerary literature found in many tombs. There is karma for each path, or an effect that results from an initial cause. It is possible that the sacred writings taken into the grave by the deceased were not accessed solely through monetary purchase, political patronage, or superstitious fear. Rather than being given by temple mentors, they may have been given to the deceased to guide her to a spiritual journey that reflected her life's legacy. Funeral versus initiatory literature. The literature we reviewed was mainly found in tombs and shrines for the dead. It has been assumed that funeral literature was intended for the dead and not the living. The renowned Canadian philosopher Manly Palmer Hall, who spent his lifetime researching and preserving the mysteries of ancient civilizations, was convinced otherwise. According to Hall, evidence of Egypt's secret doctrine was abundant in Egypt's funerary works. Based on his conversations and correspondence with leading Egyptologists of the 20th century, as some view the contents of the Book of the Dead, he writes the following. The ancient initiatory literature describes the awakening of innate consciousness through philosophical, religious, and magical means. Psychological studies of myths and cultural traditions reveal that what may seem a simple tale, when understood in its literal terms, is a profound truth encapsulated in symbolic representations. Complex symbolism or language is deliberately used to keep information out of the public's grasp, or when the reader's perceptions must be used only. It is always the reader's consciousness that determines the outcome. Considering this, we can say that many of the so-called funerary texts were intended, but not limited to, the deceased. The sacred science shared the common language of the solar, lunar, and stellar temple traditions. This tradition was not only beneficial to the soul of the Egyptians. Among its primary functions was innate awakening consciousness, which enables transformation. As their magical practice records reveal, the body, mind, and environment were all capable of this transformation. In this way, the legend of life regeneration in Egypt is embedded in funerary literature and serves an essential initiatory function for the living. Despite their devout intentions and human aspirations, the sanctuary's residents were ordinary people. It was considered both the embodiment and the custodian of an already archaic tradition for those who brought this wisdom to the living. Time-honored books, sacred dramas, mystic rites, and divine words provided spiritual meaning for daily life. As fascinating as their lives have been for centuries, their terms remain just as relevant today as when they passed through the doors of the divine house. Immortal magic. Nearly every culture believes that spiritual influences manifest through specific parts, centers, or body nodes. We can often find a corresponding science, medical system, or ritual discipline to support this belief. A simple expression of sacred anatomy is revealed by the anointing rituals of priestly initiation and mummification, in which 14 centers or nodes are outlined. Mummies are wrapped in amulets that reveal the body's organs and regions, which the Egyptians deemed necessary for protection after death. The charms were also intended to restore the vital functions required to fully comprehend the spiritual journey to the mortal form. During mummification, they were placed over their governing member. They were anointed with spells that later formed the Book of Going Forth. Sometimes the episodes were engraved on amulets or on papyri, placed over the governing region of the body. Living beings also use the formulas when assuming protective amulets. In the top half of the mummy wrappings was the Uadjat amulet, right eye of Heru. Besides wax or clay, it was also imprinted over the Imbana's incision on the torso. The Wadjet symbolizes the recovery of Heru's power by Jahuti after Set tore away his eye. To maintain the process of vital restoration, many offerings were made in the Uadjat's name. Uadjat was made from glazed faience, wood, granite, hematite, carnelian, lapis lazuli, gold, silver or copper. A cavernous plexus is associated with it. The Uadjat are empowered in chapter 167. Both Murti eyes are associated with Heru's two eyes, the sun and the moon. Marjet represents the day's boat, while Mesketet represents the night's boat. They are rarely depicted together, except in the regalia of certain high priests and royal figures. In Tutankhamun's mummy, the Murti were placed in a belt around his waist. The Egyptians considered the neck to be a vulnerable psychic center. All efforts were made to protect the back and the front of the neck, the living and the dead, with magical amulets and figures hung around the neck and over the pharyngeal plexus. Known as the amulet of the pillow, the Ursh was the essential protective device for the living and the ossified. Modeled after the large wooden headrests used by the Egyptians under their necks, it is made from hematite or iron substances associated with Seth's power. In chapter 166, we discover the amulet protects the neck to prevent the head from being taken from a spiritual sojourner. In her funerary aspect, Hedher is associated with the Yusek, a collar or pectoral whose gold collar brings life to the wanderer. On the day of interment, chapter 158 was recited as the collar was placed around the neck. Nerut, or the coupling of the vulture, replaced Yusek in some epochs. It was also gold and placed on the mummy's neck. This amulet, associated with the pulmonary plexus, is empowered by chapter 157. The Ab, or heart amulet, is made from a durable material, usually greenschist or carnelian. It was found after the Solar Horian epoch, first intermediate period, in the image of Kepa, the Scarabaeus Sacer beetle. The heart was placed over the mummy's removed heart, or the cardiac plexus. On its underside were engraved chapters 26 to 30 of the Book of Going Forth. In embalming ceremonies, the Sen priest who wore the mask of Anpu placed the amulet in the mummy to ensure that the heart would remain with the soul. Because of its presence, the heart was commanded not to oppose or speak against the initiate, so that the continuous transformation could occur. Asar's Jed pillar is described in chapter 155. There are vertebrae associated with this Nita's spinal column. In this context, Jed means firmness, stability, and setting upright. While the chapter specifies gold, most examples are wood, wax, or gilded bitumen. Some have been rendered in lapis lazuli, carnelian, and mother of emerald inlay. Jed was placed parallel to the spinal cord on the torso, corresponding to the body's epigastric solar plexus. Ankhamu, rose flower juice, was dripped on the Jed, then placed parallel to the spinal cord on the torso. This raised the body into the inner world. Chapter 156 describes Orset's Thet, known as the buckle, which brought the wearer the virtues of this goddess, particularly her words of power, spells, and magic. Thets were carved from red jasper, carnelian, porphyry, glass, faience, and sycamore wood, and dipped in Ankhamu flower juice. This amulet brought Orset's protection of the body's members. Chapter 151 describes the empowerment of the four sons of Heru in the body, though it is often carved on the walls of the funerary chamber. Inset promises to make thy house flourish. Harpy says he will protect the head and body members. Damutef will set you upon thy feet for all time, and Quetzenuf will place thy heart upon its throne within thy body. Our sons of Heru were depicted on the mummy, over the removed organs with which they were associated, Inset, liver, Damutef, stomach, Quetzenuf, intestines, and Harpy, lungs. In pairs, they face each other on either side of the mummy's torso. It was an integral amulet from the mummified body, usually made of feldspar carved and covered with gold leaf. It was worn on either side of the lower torso or thighs, and worn as a pendant for the living. Chapter 159a in the Book of Going Forth details the formula used for placing the amulet, which gives youth and vigor under the auspices of the nursing deity, a form of nebbed head. This plexus is in the sacrum and is associated with the pelvic or coccygeal network. Shuti, or the amulet of feathers, is composed of two feathers of the ostrich placed at the throat, the brow, or the thigh. As described in Chapter 83, the rubric for empowering the soul to become endowed with an Ankh and gain the powers of the Neteru is presented. The initiate thus takes on the form of the phoenix of transformation into cosmic life, the Bennu bird. Asar's feather is mentioned in an inscription of the third chamber of the West Roof Shrine at Dendera as one of the 105 amulets accompanying him to his house of gold. In addition, the section lists spell magical figures and ceremonies associated with the Osirian mysteries conducted at the temple, which empower the aspirant to become Asar with his mastery over the regions of the inner life. He was carved on stelae, painted on coffins and worn as an amulet of lapis lazuli or carnelian. The initiate would wear it on their arms, legs, or grasp it in their hands. It promised eternal life. Gold amulets such as the Sa amulet conveyed the all-encompassing protection of cosmic energy, with their potency to penetrate and revitalize all the body through subtle realms. To surround the soul with protective emanations, it was placed at the feet of the mummy and around the mummy in niches of the funerary chamber. The Ahat, or hydrocephalus amulet, was usually rendered in gold on a round disc placed under the head. At the medulla, where the brain connects with the spinal cord, are the 12 cranial nerves. There are 4 sacred names inscribed on it that are believed to preserve the body's heat, surrounding Newt as a cow. The Book of the Mistress of the Secret Temple describes how it is placed so that flames shoot from the head of the initiate in the dark world, so that he will not be repelled from any portal in the Duat. The chapter is also called the Book of the Mistress of the Hidden Temple. As the receptacle of identity, the head was the body part by which the sojourner was recognized in the spiritual realm. Passaging through these realms was enabled by the warmth beneath the head. During earlier periods, this spell was inscribed on papyrus and placed behind the head of the mummy. This amulet's symbolism mirrors human illumination, resulting from spiritual achievement. This enlightenment is symbolized by the solar orb at the crown of the head in many cultures. Ancient Egyptians believed specific centers in the physical organism were sacred because of the associations of the body's organs and components with the Neteru. Furthermore, the mummified body overall assumed the form of Asar, created by reassembling 14 parts into a frame where ordinary functions became divine entities. As the amulet spells and Neteru images govern each piece, this fusion keeps the sojourner connected to both worlds and gives them passage. In funerary magic texts, the spiritual metamorphosis of the physical body is also mentioned. Chapter 42a of the Book of Going Forth describes the divinization of all body parts. As soon as an initiate ascends to their realm, his body is identified with the Neteru, and his perishable form is replaced by their eternal, imperishable principles. The assembled powers of Neteru handle the spiritual fabrication of a new heavenly body. Many body parts are cited at different epochs, but 22 is most frequently mentioned. According to the Old Kingdom Pyramid texts, there are 26 bodies enumerated for divination, the same number reported by Diodorus as the number of Asar's sacred relics distributed by Orset in ancient times to establish the religious centers of his worship. It is 21 in the papyrus of Ani of the New Kingdom, but 23 body members are enumerated in the Ramesside text of the same period, as they become incorporated in divine life after the solar transformation. Despite wealth being the most cited factor for placing large quantities of amulets and sacred objects on the mummy, other factors also determine their presence, as even modestly buried mummies are found, with many items fashioned from clay or glass. Tutankhamun's mummy was adorned with 143 amulets and protective objects. Inscriptions at the Karnak Temple detail several religious ceremonies that involved his initiation, crowning, and investiture. It explains the various descriptions of sacred centers, nodes, and body parts in the funerary literature of distinguished individuals. The traditional rejuvenation of the original body's 14 vital functions was also intended to create a new spiritual body with 22 members, and gain other metaphysical parts through temple consecration. In Egyptian metaphysics, elevating the physical body and its functions is one of the primary spiritual goals. The acquisition of the exalted senses, possessed by the Neteru and their use by the soul, reborn into sacred regions, coexisted with this process. An example of this could be found in one passage of the pyramid texts. "I'm not from the earth, I'm from the sky. As a heron, I have soared to the sky and kissed the sky as a falcon. As a locust that shadows the sun, I have reached the sky." Number 467. Utterance. Entombment ceremonies. Esoteric Egyptian religion aims to transform the human fabric into divine substance, whether on the lunar, solar, or stellar paths. Death transforms the body into its rudimentary earthly component. But in the doctrine of the sacred science, shadow, soul, and spirit were also vehicles for transforming into the realm of immortality. Funerary traditions in Egypt fulfilled this plan, while maintaining the divine-human interface. Throughout Egyptian history, the cities of the dead were nearly self-contained. From the east bank of the Nile, the funerary centers were carefully separated from the commercial, residential, and religious endeavors. The mausoleum builders and their families, funerary artisans, and an entire field of priestly technicians, associated with embalming houses and temples for funeral services, lived separate from the villages and towns of the living, though they consistently enjoyed all the privileges and laws of their land. Before entombment, several specialists at the necropolis provided careful preparation and care for the deceased. As Herodotus described Egyptian funerary protocol in the 5th century BCE, the queres, undertaker, removed the body from its residence and brought it to the house of the dead. The magical reconstruction of Asar was the prototype of Egypt's funerary rites. The formulas and technical procedures were a meticulously executed science to achieve mummification through both chemical and magical means. The Utu Sembama performed the physical and religious preparations for the tomb's metamorphoses, an elaborate procedure involving the body being transformed into a Ku, glorified corpse, a permanent replica of Asar's corpse. Every step in the process coordinated the application of preservatives, the recitation of spells, and placing amulets. Besides the tomb equipment provided by the family, this led to the tremendous ceremonial investiture of the deceased in Osirian life. The Greater Cherad and the Lesser Cherad, resembling Orset and Nebhet respectively, play essential roles in mummification ceremonies. While the corpse awaits entombment, they reenact an ancient tradition of reassembling the body of Asar, reconstituting its members with life and awakening its astral senses with chants and words of power. As the Ku undergoes this mystic symbiosis, the priestesses have the critical task of physically protecting it from Set's confederates, who represent decay and dissolution. In his entombment appears the pillar of his mother, a ceremonial officiant, concerned with the transition of the Ka. Heru assisted Orset in the funeral of Asar, and this role is usually assumed by the heir. As the Ku is buried with its possessions, he wears the sidelock of youth and ceremonial leopard skin, a reenactment of the legendary Osirian cortege. As the procession passes through the four symbolic funerary cities of Asar's burial, and then enters the necropolis, specialized mourners sing the dirges of the deceased, who are now identified with Asar in the lunar Osirian metamorphosis. It was considered the most sacred place for the departed, the location of the highest transformation, but could be offered to a virtuous soul. Whenever the Ku was present at the periodic memorial services, it must be protected from the nefarious forces of the shadow world. The ceremony of the four flames was first conducted at the burial site before the Ku was brought within the tomb to ensure its protection. Because the ceremony was very archaic, only the deceased's family could be present, along with the Lunmutef and attendants. The most secret of all Egyptian rites is said to have been passed down from the time of Hajedef, son of Khufu, who concealed it in a coffer in a temple inscribed by Djahouti. The Book of Going Forth describes the ceremony in chapter 137. The four sons of Heru are engraved on the arms of the attendants, holding four torches made of red linen, which represents the four flames created for the sojourner. When the spell for protection of the Ku and its house is pronounced, the torches are put out in clay bowls, filled with incense and cow's milk, symbols of birth. In the mummy's chamber, four bricks are ceremonially placed and spells are recited by the ceremonially pure Lunmutef in each quarter. An ancient rite itself, the evocation of spirits for protection from the four directions, recalls the guardians of the celestial quarters and ensures the forces that bring about the solar Harlan metamorphosis. Having established the heavenly pillars, the sun can now proceed on its natural journey from east to west, joined at the gate of darkness by the sojourning soul currently aboard the solar bark. Ritually purifying and protecting the place of transformation is now complete. Afterward, the most sacred magic ritual, the opening of the mouth, was performed by Ari Maket, guardian of the scale, and Samath, kinsman or friend. A title was also given to the high priest of Abydos, who conducted the annual mysteries of reviving Asar in his dormant state. The new pharaoh assumed the role of the Heru incarnates at royal funerals. Besides wearing Heru's sidelock of youth, he also wears sacred leopard skin. The opening of the mouth ceremony was not only reserved for funerary rites. This is the quintessential ritual for imbuing statues with spiritual power and restoring health to the sick. Despite being performed by priests of all traditions, it was reserved only for critical rites of passage and not casual functions. The stellar metamorphosis is preceded by the opening of the mouth ritual. The Unra, who opens the mouth, bestows the sojourner with the rose quartz Peshenkef scepter upon entering the heavenly realm. As the lifeless form merges with cosmic life, the Seb-Ur scepter is given in the shape of the constellation Draco, empowering it with speaking and eating functions. Afterward, the deceased is given the Ur Hekau, the instrument for transmitting the Sa of divine beings. The funerary liturgy is spoken of smiting or striking the recipient initially with these scepters to restore the lost functions. This may awaken latent senses as if transitioning from an earthly to cosmic existence. During the mouth's opening ceremony, rites were performed solely for the statue of the deceased, which was to house the Ka after transformation. Their eyes or skulls were discovered mutilated to ensure the embodiment of the Ka only into its specially consecrated image. There was such importance attached to this image in the afterlife than any other likeness which may have been made during the lifetime of the deceased, that it was installed, along with a Ka statue, in the tomb, to prevent evocation of the dead into the unwholesome atmosphere outside of the consecrated grave. It is exemplified in the so-called reserve heads, of early dynastic tombs. Immediately following the opening of the mouth, the first act of self-empowerment by the deceased is celebrated. With all her abilities spiritually restored, the funerary feast allows those present to share in the magic gained from the three changes in the tomb. Because of the belief that occult energy emanated from the sky and the grave, the Egyptian funerary ceremony allowed a transference of this power through its time-honored communion ritual. The setem provided provisions for the new sojourner and her guests, including bread, meat freshly slaughtered, beer, fruit and grains. A group of magical specialists came forward following the funeral feast to maintain the tomb and ensure the continuation of the ka. The afterlife was expected to reflect life on Earth, and one's duties could include carrying out specific tasks in the service of Asa, regent of Sekhet Etepet, the Elysian Fields. Through the Ushabdiu, magical figures made to provide security and comfort, the Setem helped the deceased fulfill this duty. Every sculpture was fabricated in her mirror image to increase her power in the shadow worlds, where anything was possible with magic. The Ushabtiu fulfilled their tasks each day of the year, 365, but the number probably ensured that the ka was vitalized by the physical powers contained in the figures. Chapter 6a of the Book of Going Forth describes how to empower the Ushabtiu with life and assume the deceased's identity. Afterward, the spirits are directed to perform any task they are given. With the help of these attendant spirits, fields were cultivated, the land was irrigated, and sand was transported from the eastern to the western zones of the sacred region. Traditionally, these acts have been interpreted as literal expectations for the deceased in the afterlife, but they may also be viewed as spiritual metaphors. Magical power was gained by the soul of the Elysian Fields through the cyclic return of the Nile's inundation, planting and harvesting food, and movement of the winds. The deceased was elevated from the concerns of human life and included in natural events through the Neteru, who had embodied them. The Ushabtiu is embodied in the posture of invocation, with the right hand extended toward the figures. Translated versions of the formula may be recited, but the ancient words are more robust. I have opened your faces, Ushabtiu. If Asa asks you to perform work in the domain of the Neteru, you will do so. It is your responsibility to remove any obstacles that have been placed in her path. Obey the one who created you. Do not obey her enemies. It is I who am here. I am you. The Book of Going Forward. Human life is intrinsically linked to divine energy, according to Egyptian metaphysics. Various spiritual or subtle planes are separated by the material world in varying degrees, but these worlds can be accessed by altering the earthly veil. This access is gained and maintained through transformation, according to sacred science. As if returning to an origin were implied, the Egyptian concept of death was called mena, which means to moor or to arrive at a harbor. By living a life of exemplary character, the dead had passed the judgment of the Neteru after passing through the locations and transitions of the Duat, and knowing the commanding words of power over the denizens of those regions. The birth of a child was expressed by the word mez, which means to bring forth. Curiously, embalmers were called mesu art, they bring forth to the dark regions, and Asa was called Mesu M-Um, who brings forth a second time. Birth and death transform life. They strengthen our connection to divine energy. According to the Egyptians, we can harness their power to heal and regenerate, provided that the environment in which they are brought forth facilitates that process. Death is always the theme of the temple, and birth is always the theme of the tomb. Although neither the condition of the body nor the process of transformation was an essential requirement, they are often called magical traditions, but their value has deteriorated over time, and they are no longer relevant to today's society. Like in Egypt, magic is a technology of transformation, its primary product being the transformed human being, whose innate consciousness has been reawakened. Magic transforms division into a synthesis in mythology, maintaining divine order. This is the central theme of Egyptian thought. In temple inscriptions, the sacred house of the Nita is magically transformed into a mirror of the universe, extending the heavenly realm to earth. In addition, the texts of the pyramids and tombs magically transform the initiate into a being capable of entering the spiritual planes and taking part in cosmic life. The public perception of Egypt has for many decades been shaped almost only by 19th century discoveries and examinations of mummies, tombs, and papyri, as well as the detailed remarks of classical historians, such as Herodotus and Diodorus, about the burial customs of the ancient Egyptians. The profusion of relics and comments of this sort gives the impression that the culture was preoccupied with the continuation of life, even in the face of death, and that most of the arts and sciences were devoted to funerary matters. The archaeologists studying our own culture 1,000 years from now will undoubtedly think the same of us, having only 20th century landfills filled with the residues of life extension drugs and cosmetics, and cemeteries cluttered with embalmed bodies and objects of religious sentiment to study. A civilization leaves behind only a skeleton of its complete form, and whether it is modern America or ancient Egypt, the entire value system expressed by that culture must be considered before it can be understood. Researchers studying the earliest funerary sites have found that even in pre-dynastic times, the dead were sent to the inner life following the practices later on. Throughout the 4,000-year history of dynastic Egypt, the fundamental procedures for spiritual preparation varied little. There is no evolution of funerary ritual, only a gradual elaboration over time, though even this is an assumption. The earliest funerary sites were indeed highly elaborate, but the number of tombs and burials in pristine condition is small compared to those from later times. An ancient necropolis. The continuation of a person's existence after death in Egypt was firmly believed, and every necropolis reflects that belief in its art, architecture, and literature. The deceased's body lay on its left side, facing west in Upper Egypt. In this gesture, the feet are placed in the north, the place of imperishable existence. The dead in the delta are buried facing east, symbolically promising renewal like the sun and wandering stars. It is always clear from the earliest graves that they are concerned for the sustenance and comfort of the departed, including food and objects of daily use in the grave. In Egypt's history, the earliest grave sites are found at two major burial sites, Saqqara, near the Delta district of Lower Egypt, and Abydos, in the valley of Upper Egypt. Both lie on the west bank of the Nile, also known as the region of the dead. Early on, it was customary for those able to make the journey to maintain cenotaphs at both great mortuary complexes, Abydos in the south and Saqqara in the north. Old-timers believed that the god kings in old times originated in the mortuary complex near Abydos, in the ancient town of Abedju, near Men-Nepha, Memphis. Saqqara's necropolis distinguished its elaborate white limestone walls, separating the city from the great cemetery. Here are Egyptian burials dating back 5,000 years. Horemheb reinstituted the old kingdom custom of maintaining dual burial sites in Dynasty 19. After a long lapse in the ancient tradition, his successors, the Ramessides, carefully revived and pursued these. In the Old Kingdom, necropolis burial places comprised individual and family tombs, each of which was a mastaba. The mastaba, which was of varying sizes and elaborate designs, was astronomically oriented in some respects to the northern pole star, to bind it to the imperishable forces of the cosmos. During the annual funerary celebrations and the lunar cycle, the necropolis priests presented offerings to living visitors within the chambers of the structure, which housed the dead. Besides the formal rooms, the mastaba contained other rooms adorned with formulae, intended to ensure the stability of the spirit in the inner life. During the Old Kingdom, spells and rituals were usually illustrated, which has been misunderstood in modern times. Depending on the literal translation of the figures, the deceased may have led an army, hunted marshlands, practiced veterinary medicine, and collected taxes, all seemingly unrelated professions for one individual. Despite this, the illustrations are metaphorical and can be found in every period tomb and every class of people. Each scene represents a spiritual reality, expressed in earthly terms, much as the corporeal world was viewed as a mirror of the cosmic one. As a symbol of overcoming the adversary, leading an army was like hunting in an ancient marsh, and collecting taxes was like balancing accounts to pay one's moral debts. Following periods of anarchy during which ancient tombs were desecrated, rock cliff tombs in remote locations were designated as burial sites by the royal house and its clans to ensure their isolation from such events later. Their layout was like the mastaba, with a reception hall, formal rooms, and a burial shaft cut deep into the rock. Under the mastaba, the dead were buried in shafts dug deep into the rock. As a result, the traditional mortuary complexes of earlier times were eventually superseded by crypts in the valleys of Egypt in the New Kingdom. Tomb architecture reflects the same design used for all classes throughout dynastic history. The shadow world's terrain. Six sacred areas are clearly vilified, while the seventh is the sarcophagus. In the stairwell or entrance of the mortuary are often depicted the names and titles of the deceased and scenes of entering the west or the inner life, greeting or presenting offerings to the Neteru. During the Old Kingdom, the living could pass through this area. Often found here are inscriptions from the negative confession. The first chamber of the corridor of the tomb has reliefs claiming hymns to the sun, perhaps depicting the sun's journey through the hours of night and day. Ceilings are often adorned with representations of the heavens, the stars, and decan gods. These inscriptions symbolize a deceased person's initial entry into the sky region. The Old Kingdom's necropolis chambers were usually open to the family or priests of the necropolis, and included an offering table for funerary goods. The walls display scenes of baking, beer making, and the slaughtering of animals, all symbolic of the living maintaining the spiritual life of the deceased as the sojourner begins his ascent. Cairn niches hold the sanctuaries of the inner life spirits, the first to be encountered on the spiritual journey. The Book of the Duat is carved into the walls of the Ranaside tombs, serving as a guide through the various regions and paths that the deceased might encounter. In the Old Kingdom, the second chamber was called the Third Passageway of Nita, or Sanctuaries, where the Neteru of the East and West repose. In the Old Kingdom, this was typically the Per Ka, or the chamber where the dead entered to gain sustenance and return to the spirit world. Egyptologists believed it was a chamber where the royal guard stood watch during aristocrats' funeral ceremonies. Funerary goods are also kept in niches here, with inscriptions depicting the manufacture of the articles, metalworking, beadmaking, carpentry, weaving, and glassblowing. The scene from the Final Judgment is engraved in the Middle Kingdom. Here, the two doorkeepers represent the soul's entry into divine life, or its return to earth. The symbolism of two is repeated throughout this area, alluding to the importance of making moral choices or the necessity of splitting paths between the physical and spiritual realms. In every mastaba or tomb, a pit or hollow chamber was called the Hall of Waiting or the Hall of Hindering. The cavity or chamber may have been used to divert water from flash floods occurring in the desert or deter tomb robbers. A symbolic use is also proposed, representing the deceased's journey through the spiritual realms. There is the possibility of returning to Earth or reincarnation in the pit, but follows judgment scenes and often has a starry ceiling overhead. Images depicting hunting or harpooning were prevalent in the Old Kingdom, a symbol of overcoming the carnal forces of the physical world and entering the spiritual realm. The deceased was frequently buried in the pit in earlier times, which served as a portal into another realm. House of Gold held a sarcophagus, and the symbolism of four is repeated throughout. The sepulchre is usually surrounded by four pillars or storerooms, and in the Middle Kingdom, four niches are carved into each wall to house the divinities of the four funerary directions, or Heru's four genies. Four perfectly preserved golden shrines surround Tutankhamun's chamber in his tomb. It is another starry sky above, with Nut-Nita of cosmic birth overhead. Inscriptions in this chamber depict stages of transformation passed by the deceased, from forms of bird and insect kingdoms to ossification and birth scenes as a child of the Neteru. A chamber of four symbolizes the containment of spiritual energy within a physical vehicle, conveying the ultimate purpose of a tomb, the birth of the deceased into immaterial realms as a spiritual being. As the last or seventh chamber of the tomb, a sarcophagus is usually carved from a single monolithic block of rare stone. Alabaster, red sandstone, and granite are commonly used, to ensure that the journey between the many realms of the inner life is not hindered by antagonistic forces. Spells and hymns are written on the sarcophagus walls. Based on the evidence, none of the alleged builders of the 35 significant pyramids in Egypt were buried within them. A few sites have yielded funerary remains that were found to have been used as tombs for individuals. Pyramids as tombs are almost evenly divided among Egyptologists. While there is no conclusive documentation for the pyramids serving essential funerary functions, all agree that they did. On the West Bank, the place of sunset and the cessation of light at dusk symbolize a gateway to the inner life. A recent discovery that the pyramid shape preserves organic material lends credence to the belief that the pyramids may have enhanced mummification. Several mortuary temples near the pyramid support the concept that a vast complex of functions, burial was one part, administered at the necropolis. Symbolically, Nut enfolds the deceased in her arms, absorbing their souls into her body by spreading herself over them. Cult of the funerary. Funerary tradition in Egypt was a well-developed system in which all levels of society took part, from peasants to royalty. The site of the funeral itself, members of the family or paid clergy repeated various ceremonies for the deceased. In Egypt, this phenomenon has been described as either a funeral cult or an ancestral cult, overlooking the sociological aspects, which are well known. The completion of the mummification process marked the beginning of the deceased's journey to the sacred land. It was affected by the funerary rituals and feast, followed by the journey itself, undertaken with help from the funerary literature, priests, and family members. To begin its arduous journey through the inner life, the mummy required symbolic restoration of vital functions before entombment. Funeral feasts were not limited to the departed. Through this rite of communion, the participants shared the new life entered by the person of second birth. This rite of communion forms the foundation of other religious concepts found in the Christian religion, which expresses the conversion of matter back into spirit through the partaking of bread and wine. Because of its transformative process, the rite empowers the communicant to join with divine life. Most agrarian societies maintain this spiritual view of food and express it through elaborate ceremonies at birth, weddings, and funerals with ritual feasts, symbolically uniting participants through consuming foods with multiplied life-giving properties. Literature associated with funerals. During the foreign conquests of Egypt, wholesale plundering of tombs was an accepted mode of livelihood. Invasion by foreign peoples dates back to Dynasty 22, when Libyan chiefs swept through Lower Egypt. The extent to which sacred literature may have been lost in the quest for wealth is speculative. But there are examples from all periods that provide more than just a glimpse of the written funerary traditions. Late in the 19th century, Egyptology developed into an organized academic discipline. During the less restrictive rule of the Muhammad Ali dynasty, it was mainly because of the cooperative efforts of European and American universities. Although there were mutual antagonisms and tremendous technical difficulties, many Egyptian antiquities were saved that otherwise would have been lost or destroyed. Documents from various Egyptian periods that we know were produced for funerary use were also made by individual English, French, German, and Egyptian explorers. Mummies were found in tombs, on coffins, and wrapped in sarcophagi. In most cases, the content of such prayers is similar and repetitious, being concerned primarily with the maintenance of the tomb, the provision of sustenance to the spirit, the restoration of the deceased's functions, and prayers to meet specific needs in the inner life of the deceased. There are, however, curious exceptions, particularly with funerary relics of royalty and the clergy. Clearly, these items are more prosperous and more elaborate, giving credence to the assumption made by the early Egyptologists that funerary magic, like rich tomb equipment, was only available to the wealthy. Even though so few examples of funerary literature come from the graves of ordinary people, this does not imply that it was reserved only for the rich and powerful. In the wealthy and nobility tombs, texts written on papyrus or inscribed on walls can be found. Less wealthy individuals had access to the same sacred literature. Portions may have been recited during the embalming process, much like today's Catholic Requiem Mass for the deceased. During the annual Great Offering ceremony, the funerary priests read other parts of the liturgy over a grave or over the entire necropolis. Book of Memories. Through the Ka image, both the book of the opening of the mouth and the liturgy of funerary offerings are essential funerary books. Specifically, the former describes the complete reconstitution of physical functions and form, while the latter describes the transformation of material offerings into a spiritual substance. Both pieces complement each other, and they were used together. The book of the ceremony opening of the mouth contains Middle Kingdom texts from the coffins of Peta Amun Apt and Butchai Amun. During the funeral feast which followed the entombment of the mummy, a series of 28 ceremonies were held to recreate the essential activities of the deceased in their inner life, such as the body's mobility, its senses, and eating. From inscriptions at several pyramids from Saqqara, including those of Unas and Pepi I, the liturgy of funerary offerings is derived. 114 ceremonies are held during which food, drink, oils, clothing, and cosmetics are presented to the deceased, who is now awake to his inner life and restored functions. The work is also found in the mortuary of Seti I, New Kingdom, showing a remarkable consistency with the oldest examples. During the first half of this lengthy series of magical acts, the body is thoroughly cleansed symbolically by the Ka statue. As well as several lustrations with water, an exciting series of libations using oil is administered in 7 steps. As we can see here, it is an example of the legendary scent alchemy of ancient Egypt, a science that attempted to evoke transformation through sacred perfumes. It is often overlooked how important and valuable this ritual magic was to the Egyptians. A significant amount of holy oils and unguents were found in the funerary trove of Tutankhamun, but the evidence left by the ancient tomb robbers who were apprehended after pilfering only a few items was even more intriguing. As evidence of their hasty actions, they first took the contents of the unguent vases and left handprints on those vessels. In the second half of the liturgy of funerary offerings, food offerings are presented formally to the newly made up Ka, and the ritual feasting of the deceased with the living is performed. In both works, operations were performed on the Ka statue, but Egyptologists claim that the recipients of both ceremonies were the mummified bodies, possibly because of a lack of magic. The instructions, however, are self-explanatory, and the papyri and tomb walls clearly show the Ka statue played an essential role. Accordingly, the modern assumption that the Egyptians believed in a literal, physical resurrection after performing the ceremonies on their bodies is incorrect. In the transformation cycle, disintegration and decay are necessary stages. Despite being identified as funerary in spirit, both ceremonies are recorded as being performed in rites embodied images of the Neteru and notable ancestors, such as the legendary Imhotep of the Old Kingdom. This can be observed in the ritual of the divine cult, recorded at Karnak, where these ancient ceremonies were not reserved only for burial, but could also confer the functions of the living on disembodied entities. Interaction between two living complexes of eternal life and psychical renewal. During Egypt's dynastic history, the funeral ritual was predominantly Osirian, and the myths clearly describe how the Osirified responded to purification, restoration, and feeding rituals. He was not resurrected on earth after his miraculous renewal, but his identity and functions were restored within him in the sacred land, where he assumed ruling over the souls. His son Heru then takes this role among the living, representing the Osirian principle in its renewed vital state on earth. According to the Egyptian view of life, there are many planes, dimensions, or realities. Accordingly, the application of sacred science to such rituals as prescribed in the liturgy of funerary offerings and the opening of the mouth signified a supracorporeal process. This process would provide material necessities for the deceased, who was not yet accustomed to the new world they found themselves in. In this way, the funerary works represent the many processes intended to transform the deceased on the various levels they encounter and traverse. It is called the Book of the Dead. Carl Richard Lepsius, an Egyptologist in the middle of the 19th century, translated a Ptolemaic funerary work and published it as the first Book of the Dead. There are 192 separate pieces of hymns, spells, and spiritual instructions from this one source, augmented by subsequent Egyptologists, most notably were Plate, Neville, Wallace Budge, and Allen, translated into other papyri, coffin inscriptions, and tomb inscriptions. There is a certain quantity of standardization in the arrangement of these works. The negative confession is found in every standard version of the Book of the Dead, produced by these ancient scholars. Popular understanding of the Egyptian Book of the Dead rests on the translation of the papyrus of Ani, a dynasty, 18 scribe, whose collection contains the unique texts of any source of funerary literature. This work was compiled by the eminent Sir E. A. Wallace Budge, a prolific Victorian-era researcher of Egyptian and Assyrian artifacts at London's British Museum. He translated many funerary works, and did so in an intelligent, if not poetic, way. In contrast, other books of the dead emphasize only exact word-for-word translation. The result is that even hymns and prayers are soulless, yet scholarly. Altogether, over 200 magical formulae and prayers have been assigned to Ani's book, which has also been deemed to represent the authoritative body of funerary liturgy for its time. According to Egyptologists, there are 4 recensions to this Book of the Dead. Each revision represents one of 4 different epochs that can be arbitrarily determined from the material uncovered by excavations until the beginning of the 20th century. Text from the Pyramids of Saqqara, Old Kingdom sources, Dynasty 5 Pyramids. Egyptologists maintain that the Dynasty 5 Pyramid of Unas at Saqqara is the first pyramid to be inscribed and the primary source of the pyramid texts. Also, it is the primary source extant of the Heliopolitan cosmogony, which predominated when the Unas pyramid was believed to have been built, 3500 BCE. Stellar symbolism dominates, but solar elements are also prominent. The chambers of the Unas pyramid contained 283 chapters of classical hieroglyphic text. It is believed that the entire text should function as a ritual play or ceremony, since each chapter begins with the inscription, "Recite the words." Descriptions are rendered in low relief and filled with turquoise blue paste. The Dynasty VI monuments of Teti, Papi I and II, and Mer-en-Ra, providing 759 recitations, are other sources at the Saqqara necropolis that provide texts in the same genre and period. The pyramid texts show the king's spiritual synthesis with cosmic life. Celestial phenomena and names are frequently invoked, as the royal person is incorporated into the divine scheme as the sun and star are. I am brought over to the far eastern side of the sky, where the Neteru fashioned me, wherein I was born, young and new. Number 264. Utterance. Middle Kingdom. The Theban Recension. Most of the Theban Recension can be found in the Dynasty 18 papyri of Nu, Ani, Nebseni, and Anhai. A British Museum document describes the Sekhet Iaru and Sekhet Hetepet heavens, showing the highly complex topography of the inner life, on which later works elaborate. Coffin texts are inscriptions found on coffins and inside tomb chambers of the same period, included in the Theban Recension. The coffins of the Middle Kingdom have detailed notes and a symbolic window, through which the deceased looks westward, toward the living, from the land of the dead. The Theban Recension is an illustrated guide to the Osirian experience, sometimes called the Chapters of Going Forth by Day by Egyptians. Its central theme is the assessment of the deceased, so that he may be deemed worthy of joining the Osirian realm. The psychosis theme is depicted in the literature, tombs and coffins of the time, following the following general order. 1. A great river like the Nile must be crossed by the initiate. It stands between the initiate and the kingdom of Assar. Watery regions are associated with the Milky Way, the portal to cosmic worlds. Stellar refers to the celestial migration of the soul, as depicted in the pyramid texts. 2. After passing through the 12 circles, the initiate must proceed to the next step, as the soul seeks entry into the bark of Ra. The theme of this phase is solar, and is filled with images of adversarial forces that impede its progression. The sun's 12 hours of pitch black or night surround the part of the dead, representing the zodiacal realms. 3. The initiate then enters the hall of the judgment, the holy chamber. Here, the negative confession is spoken, and the heart, Ab, is weighed against the feather of truth, Mart. Upon considering nature, one is judged by the 42 assessors, Marti. One can join the Neteru in the sacred land if one passes. Apep, a denizen of the Duat, one of the shadow world, swallows the soul of those who fail, and one is subject to a second death. Reincarnation is a metaphor for the return to physical life. 4. After the judgment, the initiate may enter one of the two heavens, Asar's Elysian Fields, Sekhet, Hetepet, contains 14 arts or regions, while the Bark of Heaven, Sekhet Yaru, comprises 7 arits or divisions, also known as the Great Gates. This journey can be completed by reciting the names of each gate. Each leads to a magnificent hall guarded by a gatekeeper, watcher, and herald. Each entrance is guarded by 3 terrifying gods, who are appeased by reciting their names. In the Elysian Fields, one can live an idyllic life or become a member of the divine retinue, traveling through the heavens eternally with the Neteru. The theme of this phase is lunar, since it describes the various regions and chambers within Osir's world by analogy with lunar mansions or houses. Redaction of Theban texts from the late period. This version contains documents dating after Dynasty 20. Although similar to the Theban recension, it does not show a fixed order of chapters. Late period, Site and Ptolemaic. In this incomplete collection of funerary works, Lepsius translated the first Book of the Dead to show a thorough revision of Theban recension with its fixed sequence of chapters. What are the three paths? They argue that the use of different books of the dead at other times and places were controlled by the cults in power, priesthoods whose popularity was established through political maneuvering or simply forced. The result was religious confusion. The British Egyptologist Nora Romney articulates this view when he writes, "From the Middle Kingdom onward, Heliopolitan sun worship and Osirianism became intrinsically woven together in the daily ritual, and utterances used at every stage in the ceremony reveal this theological tangle. Whether the individual's identity merges with the constellation of Orion or with the gods Ra, Asar, or Heru in the funerary inscriptions, a theological tangle is unlikely. Although the emphasis on the fate of the deceased varies in funerary collections from various periods, the essential premise is the same. The dead are transformed into divine beings who enjoy both material and immaterial benefits. These cosmic cycles of Taurus, Aries, and Pisces, the epochs encompassing dynastic Egypt, offer an interpretation of the three paths described by the Egyptians as three transformations of the soul. These three paths align thematically with the stellar, solar, and lunar concepts emphasized in funerary literature, showing the recipient's spiritual destiny. By applying a symbolist approach, these versions of funerary literature can be linked to the last three equinoctial periods of the processional Great Age. Stella, the Old Kingdom, in texts from this era, the individual is described as an entry point into cosmic life as a star. The goal is to transform from human to divine existence. Under ancient bloodlines, this distinction is the birthright of the royal progeny, especially the one closest to the Neteru. Non-royal persons have also taken part in this spiritual synthesis. This funerary tradition also emphasizes another entire idea, that human existence can be elevated into a conscious presence that is cosmic in scope. The Old Kingdom's pyramid texts also express many solar concepts, that these are subordinate to the goal of entering the firmament as equal to the Neteru. In the Taurian era, the stellar theme predominates, but enigmatically, salient elements are revived and disclosed by hermetics of Egypt's last Renaissance, the Greco-Roman period. From the Middle to the New Kingdom, Solar Horian, the goal of this literature is mastery of two opposing worlds, the physical, Set, and the spiritual, Heru. While some transformational experiences are expressed, the acquisition of magical power through mastery of adversarial forces is the central theme. As one journeys through the areas of night and day with the sun, one knows the names of places, gates, and spirits in the duet. During the Age of Aries, the theme is the preservation of natural order and the expansion of personal power. Lunar Osirian period. Individuals in these works aspire to enter Amantet, the mirror of life on earth, and the realm of Asar. Upon being judged or balanced with its earthly past and being freed from its physical demands, the pleasures of earthly existence are continually dispensed. In the lunar stages of incubation and transformation, the initiate becomes Osirified and elevates his physical nature. The goal expressed in the Age of Pisces is continuity of consciousness between these states or transitions. These three themes, Stellar, Solar Horian, and Lunar Osirian, all represent spiritual paths that determine the nature and scope of the post-mortal journey. If any of these themes articulated the spiritual sojourn of the deceased, then funerary literature, tomb decoration, and sometimes body preparation would be adapted accordingly. Apart from the historical and cosmic epochs that define these metaphysical destinations, other undetermined factors may have contributed to their fusion at a particular historical juncture in Egyptian history. Book of Ramesside. These works, dating to the beginning of the New Kingdom in Dynasty 19, are distinct from the period's funerary literature and Egyptian history. Combining philosophical, magical, and deeply religious themes, they articulate the deceased's stellar, solar Horian, and lunar Assyrian objectives. According to the pyramid writings of the Old Kingdom, the cosmogony of the Ramesside books is derived from the Heliopolitan stellar theme. This archaic tradition was seriously revived under Horemhap, the founder of Dynasty 19. Contrary to the centuries-old pharaonic line of Theban nobles he replaced, he may have been motivated by his ancestral roots. He was from a region of the delta near Heliopolis. There is also a possibility that Horemhap's renaissance was also in response to the religious chaos unleashed on all levels of Egyptian society by his predecessor, Akhenaten, who instituted a fundamentalist view of the solar cosmology with the literal practice of sun worship. In the aftermath of the catastrophic period, funerary imagery returned to the ancient stellar cosmogony, merging it with the solar theme of the deceased traveling through cosmic realms, as established by sunset and sunrise. Royal funerals of the period portray imposing solar Horian images, with the ascending king assuming the role of Heru the Avenger and vanquisher of darkness. However, the funerary compositions of the Ramesside period are also balanced with lunar Assyrian concepts, which articulate organic metamorphosis through cyclic transformations. Together, the Ramesside sacred texts show a distinctive approach to spiritual symbiosis. The lunar Assyrian experience purifies the physical form through cyclic processes and enlivens it. It incorporates the stellar theme to lift the soul to the cosmic realm of Neteru and the solar Horian journey to ensure natural order and continuance. The following works are found in part or in the Ramesside tombs of Upper Egypt, mostly inscribed on the walls, sarcophagi, and ceilings of the mausoleums of Ramesses I through the IX, Seti I to the III, Thutmose III, Horemhap, and Merimptah. These works are also found at the Osirian, a ritual precinct near Abydos Temple, with no funerary significance. Starting at the tomb entrance and moving toward the sarcophagus chamber, the texts were typically arranged. 1. The Litany of Ra. 2. A Book of Caverns. 3. The Gates of Heaven Book. 4. The Divine Cow Book. 5. The Book of What Happens in the Shadow World. 6. The Book of Day. 7. The Night Book. Ra's Litany. Ramesside tradition is primarily stellar and solar Horian. Through its words of power, it strives to invite transformation into the solar principle. The litany enumerates the sacred names of Ra at the entrances to many of the Ramesside tombs. 75 invocations are recited, each of which depicts one of the forms of Ra. Their purpose is to provide the king, who has been Osirified, with the second transformation as the solar principle by recapitulating the sun's primordial genesis and the acquisition of forms symbolized by the divine names. There are several sources for the litany, including the shroud of Thutmose III, the mausoleum of Nefertari in the valley, and many dynasties' 18 coffins. Kshat and Kerered, Book of Caverns. As this work is inscribed in the Osirian of Abydos and several Ramesside tombs, but is uncommon as a funerary work, there is a probability that it was not intended strictly for funerary use. It comprises 6 divisions that represent 6 processes or transformations, as well as registers that describe a region with 29 caverns. Quereret also means envelopes or cocoons. The relationship between the 29-day synodic lunar month and the caverns suggests a cycle of organic gestation. First, the sojourner enters the region, and Ra reveals himself as to its master. I know your names, your secrets, and your caverns. I know what you live from when you are regent. The shadow world orders you to live. When you hear the utterances of the Osirify, your throats breathe. When I pass through the shadow world, your souls are powerful. You are influential in your caves when I enter the west. I can hear from you. Let me call you by your name. Introduction to the Book of Caverns. The Book of Gates describes the journey of the royal soul through the 12 gates of the west, now embodied in the body of the sun god. Gate 1 is entered from the Nile as the sun bark travels west along the celestial river. Gate 6 leads to Asar's judgment hall. At gate 12, the eastern vestibule is opened, and the soul is reborn at dawn with the sun. Ra descends into the region of Asar and revives the Nita of the dead with words of power and the light of his disc in his book. The work is clearly alchemical because of these horrific images, revealing how light transforms flesh into the regenerated matter. Those who oppose the sun are thus destroyed. Their heads, hearts, souls, and shadows are consumed in fiery cauldrons. A book of gates, or pylons, Shat and Sebekhed. It is a work of solar Horian art engraved on the alabaster sarcophagus of Seti I and the corridor walls leading to the Osirion at Abydos. The material is believed to have ancient origins and is intensely magical. There is a celestial river with a right and left bank, and there are 12 gates, each guarded by a serpent. The sun bark of Ra traverses the river by entering the west horizon. The gates of Horemheb are depicted as barriers. In the fourth division, a curious register describes the origin of the four races according to the Egyptians, who came into being through the actions of the Neteru. In the Book of Gates, the deceased has become part of the sun, traveling on the sky's bark to the mountain of the west, where they receive power symbols. The consequences of immoral acts are articulated throughout the 12 pylons, followed by regeneration and birth into a new cycle. The sojourner approaches a sacred pool of fire, inhabited by a divine cobra at the fifth gate. The deceased has authority over this gate, as Ra informs the being in this region. O you Neteru guard, this holy pool that grants water to the who presides over the silent region. Its water is meant for the Osirified, its freshness for this one. The flame of your breath and your magic are directed against the souls of those who may come near the Osirified with evil intent. Divine Cow, a Book of Wisdom. Rameses II, III, VI, Seti I, and a tomb enclosing Tutankhamun's sarcophagus contain this text and the more ancient pyramid texts. The legend of the destruction of humanity is also known as the legend of the destruction of society. The text is usually engraved in a small chamber, accessible through the tomb's Hall of Columns. The legend provides a fictional account of the origin of humans, and the genealogy of the Neteru of the sky, and their relationship to life on Earth. The story describes Ra's displeasure with men, and desires to depart from the sky. The Neteru eventually restore order, and allow Ra to govern the heavens peacefully, after humans are punished. The text contains another legend called The Chapter of the Divine Cow. The newt is the sky spirit, symbolized by the divine cow, whose milk feeds the calves of all living things and manifests in the Milky Way region. Sky travelers can use this text to destroy the cosmic serpents that obstruct Ra's path during his celestial journeys at a timeless time. Ra also promises to transmit the words of power that guarded him against these attacks to Asar and his magicians. Ancient Egyptian snake charmers were believed to possess the ability bequeathed by the arcane revelations of this work for thousands of years. Egyptians believed that the recitation of the legend, passed on to magical power. Ra becomes imbued with Nita's force. If he meets other requirements, he must bathe in Nile water, wear new white sandals and linen clothing, and be anointed with sacred oil after a 9-day purification. During the ceremony, incense must be burned, and the image of Maat must be painted on the tongue in green ink. A priestess who assumes the role of a serpent goddess will also accompany him on the journey to protect him from any denizens he might encounter. The Shadow World Book. Anduat or Shatanduat. Among the works of Dynasty 19, Turin Papyrus is an early version of the New Kingdom's text. The Egyptian tradition was called the Book of the Secret Chamber, and it should initiate a select few into the realm of inner life. The Ramesside version is unique. 12 chapters describe the 12 hours of night darkness, when the sun passes through the Duat. Our goddess and the warder or gate of each division are sacred names. In the fifth hour, an alchemical scene depicting the soul as Sokar merging with the sun shows the soul awakening from within its region. This text describes the journey about to be undertaken. Here we have the ability of the mysterious forces of what is in the hours and then Eteru, the knowledge of the power of those in the shadow world. Their sacred rituals and what they do are described here. The understanding of what Ra says to them, their gates, and how the Great One passes through them. Its knowledge of the movement of the hours and their Neteru, knowledge of the powerful and abated. Introduction to the Book of What is in the Shadow World. The most complete version is found in the tomb of Seti I in the Valley of the Kings, and highly detailed art is in the tomb of Ramesses VI at its exact location. Besides being found in Thutmose I's grave, it has also been found in papyri at Leiden, Berlin, and Turin, all regarded as being highly magical. According to scholars, the work only reflects the theology of the Amun priesthood of Upper Egypt, conservators of Theban cosmology. The result shows a stellar theme with solar Horian elements, showcasing the 12-hour nocturnal cycle of the sun and the solar journey with which the sojourner is identified. This work alludes to reincarnation. In the 12th hour, we see the bark of the sun being towed backward by beings entering the night serpent's body from its tail. In the mouth, the aged figures become younger and emerge as newborns, while the sun is transformed into Khepri, who flies into the sky. Book of the Sky. Ramesses' books include several cosmological texts, often called astronomical ceilings, because of their location. The Book of Day is featured in several places on the ceiling of Ramesses VI's tomb. It describes the 12 hours of the diurnal cycle in which the reborn sun, the king, as a winged scarabaeus, is brought forth in the east by Newt, assisted by Orset and Nebthed. As a solar divinity, the king describes the appearances, names, and descriptions of the hours in hymns. The divine inhabitants of the sky welcome the king, now Anita, and his bark passes through each hour. Several places in Ramesses VI's tomb bear inscriptions for the Book of Night, intended to be used with the Book of Day. The text derives from Old Kingdom sources and describes the nocturnal journey of the sun after it has disappeared behind the western mountain. Besides listing the 12 hours and their names, the 36 decans are defined in terms of their heavenly locations. Akhu, transfigured spirit, and the deities of the cardinal points are also present. An allusion to reincarnation is represented during the 12th hour. The nocturnal sun is transformed into a baby brought forth by Orset and Nebthed, and flies into the sky as a scarab. The Book of Newt is a fascinating text on cosmic topography. It shows the transits of the decan stars across the Earth's meridian, and depicts the death and return of celebrities seasonally becoming invisible and reappearing in the night sky. The Egyptians compared the period of invisibility of an asterism, usually lasting 70 days, to the purification of the soul during mummification. Akka, Earth Book. The work appears in the burial chambers of Ramesses VI and IX, and on the sarcophagus of Siptah. It describes the elevation of the king who represents physical matter through a nightly journey to rebirth. A new consciousness is gained through this journey, allowing past and future conditions to be known. The book has four parts. Alchemical. Akka is the neter as a double-headed lion greets the new sun at dawn, the alchemical union of opposites, and the gold of transformation. Ramesside's books illustrate the three mysteries of the soul's transformation. In the Book of Caverns, the soul enters the tomb and greets the sun, the source of all life-giving powers on earth, with the litany of Ra. It then proceeds to the organic transformation of the lunar Osirian mystery. It then moves through the passages defined in the Book of Gates, where it enters the sky and moves through the solar Horian cycle to resolve the conflicts of light and darkness. Empowerment comes from the solar divinities in the Book of the Divine Cow. The soul is welcomed into cosmic existence in the Book of What is in the Shadow World. Last, the celestial asterisms described in the Books of the Sky become the soul's companions in the stellar mystery revealed in the Book of Akka as a newly born star and a member of the cosmic realm. The three golden birth couches depicting distinctive animal images at Tutankhamun's tomb illustrate these three stages. The lioness. An image of Tefnut who, with her consort Shu, holds up the two horizons of heaven, represents stellar existence, becoming a part of the timeless eternal realm of the Neteru. Solar presence is represented by the cow, divine cow, Newt, traveling through the shadow and light worlds and taking part in the immaterial substances and activities shared by the souls living there. Reincarnation is symbolized by the hippopotamus couch in the tomb, taught the principles of organic replication, the mummification of the body, and its resurrection. According to Herodotus, the Egyptians were the first to assert that the soul of man is immortal, but when it perishes, it enters another animal, constantly returning to life after passing through different terrestrial, marine, and aerial beings. It enters a man's body and is born. In the Egyptian tradition, those words reflect a profane understanding of the spiritual experience in the inner life. Through the transformations of the tomb, funerary literature articulates the release from earthly limitations of hunger, thirst, and fatigue, and the enhancement of personal powers. From the study of specific texts, there is also convincing evidence that some rites were also meant to empower the individual to become exempt from reincarnation altogether. Egyptologists say that mummification was discovered by accident by the Egyptians during pre-dynastic times, when they noticed that dead bodies naturally dehydrated in the desert's scorching sands. It is not known why this inexpensive, simple method was not used after that point, but mummification, which involves various procedures to preserve every detail of the human body, has been practiced since ancient times. Death and birth were viewed by Egyptian funerary doctrine as the reverse and observed faces of existence, which led to a belief in reincarnation and an understanding of its processes. The entire entombment period lasted 272 days, which is the average gestation length for humans. During the annual cycle of Deccan stars, the mummification process lasted 70 days. It was often compared to the constellation Orion, which descended into the Duat or invisible atmosphere in midwinter and was reborn in spring. As a motif of cyclic return coincident with the stars, Assyrian themes of nationalism and reappearance were revived. Egypt's philosophy does not view eternal life as the continuation of the physical form, as opposed to the corruption of matter. It is thought to be a condition characterized by the continuance of consciousness. In funerary works, the deceased achieves and maintains this reality, and the elaborate funerary rituals, including mummification, are the means. The purpose of mummification was not to preserve the body but to transform it into cosmic states. Initiatory literature follows the same formula, emphasizing the use of innate consciousness to master the realities that the initiate enters after being freed from the physical realm. Both literature classes share a similar symbolism and goal. Sacred beings, birds, and other animals are represented in the writings as metaphorical for the soul's flight or descent into supra-corporeal realms. As a result, we find a common language used in the two funerary and initiatory philosophy systems that imply more than a shared vernacular.